That is.
Okay, good afternoon. My name is Travis Broughton. I work with Intel Corporation in the Open Source Technology Center. And today we've got a few of our OSIC users, the OpenStack Innovation Center that we've opened and we've been showing in our booth over there. We have a couple of the users that have actually been submitting jobs and have launched work to participate in the cluster. And what we thought we would do this afternoon is have a little conversation about what types of jobs they're using and basically what sorts of things OSIC has enabled them to do. So with that, I guess maybe if you guys can introduce yourselves first.
So I'm Joe Tellerico. I'm an engineer at Red Hat doing OpenStack performance and scale work.
Hi, I am Stig Telfer. I'm an OpenStack HPC contributor with Cambridge University.
I'm James Thorne, and I'm a cloud solution architect at Rackspace.
All right, and so Joe, maybe you could tell us a little bit about what Red Hat has been doing in the OSIC cluster.
So we had the 132 node cluster, and we were using OOO to do a deployment to determine the scalability of OOO and issues that we could run into with that. Once we had OOO up, we have a project that we're working on called Browbeat to do performance testing, monitoring, and validation of OpenStack at scale.
And Stig?
So my allocation is a 66 node bare metal allocation. And actually, I have it right now, but I can't use it for obvious reasons. But I'll be starting on it next week when I get home. And what we're going to be doing is our group comes from a scientific compute background. And we're looking at how we can use the OSIC cluster and test scale for creating an HPC-style formulation of OpenStack and use it to do performance telemetry of HPC applications and whether we can create an infrastructure which will really scale for gathering performance data.
Okay, great. And James, maybe you can tell us a little bit about how Rackspace and Intel are using OSIC ourselves to advance OpenStack.
Yeah, for sure. So I'm definitely kind of the oddball out of this group because I don't actually use the cluster. Myself and RPC or Rackspace built the Dallas cluster, and that's what these folks are using to run their tests. So between Rackspace and Intel, we're working and using the OSIC hardware to do things such as accelerated ironic development, because that's something that we want to incorporate into what we call Cloud One. So for any of you that have requested access to an OpenStack project in the environment, you've probably gone to cloudone.osic.org. That's part of the environment where we want to add ironic to in the future so we can provision bare metal instances through an OpenStack project rather than pure bare metal deployments, which these guys are using. And that requires a VPN connection, and it's a much more manual process instead of using an OpenStack project to allocate bare metal via ironic.
And actually, that raises a good point. You guys are using bare metal. We're also seeing some quoted allocations within the OpenStack cloud. Can you guys talk a little bit about why you chose to use bare metal?
Yeah, for us to use OOO, we needed bare metal allocations. And I mean, no one can really replace bare metal for us, especially nuances when it comes to networking. Not having port fast enabled and trying to have ironic deploy onto that is just an absolute mess. So there's really no substitute for bare metal in this case.
So the projects that I'm interested in to do with scientific compute are really about how we can get the benefits of software-defined infrastructure, OpenStack being the obvious example, and how can we get the benefits of all that flexibility and all that capability without paying any overhead? And so a bare metal option is, I mean, we're really working at the infrastructure level, so we're creating the OpenStack formulated to the application needs, and then we're looking at how we can bring back monitoring infrastructure to from that bare metal environment as well.
Okay, and do you have any insight into what some of the other users have been doing inside the cloud? What kind of differentiates those use cases from bare metal?
Yeah, for sure. So we have quite a few people using an OpenStack project right now. So the largest user right now is the OpenStack Infra team. So the OpenStack Infra team has a bunch of different providers, whether that's Amazon or Rackspace Public Cloud or DigitalOcean or their own gear. And there's a public-facing Grafana dashboard somewhere that shows all these different environments they use with graphs detailing API response times, the time it takes to build instances, the amount of instances they have. But they came to us when they learned that OSIC was, or the OSIC environment was being built, and asked for a large quota for an OpenStack project. So they're the largest user right now of that environment, and they're constantly spinning things up and down to gate various projects that need unit testing and all that sort of stuff. Next up, there's the OSA engineering team, so OpenStack Ansible, which was founded within Rackspace. They use it to do all-in-one installs and tests as they push updates to the repos. Also, the OSIC engineering team themselves use the environment for all-in-one installs of OSA or whatever they may be working on that allows them, or all that they only need a VM to do with, a VM to do their testing with. If they don't need bare metal, it's much easier for us just to create an OpenStack project for them, set some quotas, and then give them it, give them the environment and let them go do their work. And then there's a handful of individuals doing very small scale testing that don't require large quotas. So,
great. And so in terms of, you know, some of the goals of OSIC, we, you know, we really want to influence and benefit the community and push things upstream. Mm-hmm. Can you talk about, you know, what you've encountered and what sort of upstream changes you're seeing and hoping to see or influence?
Sure. So some of the stuff that we've driven with OOO or some heat template changing, and even the tooling we use like Rally, we found that we launched 24,000 instances, but Rally only deleted at 20 instances at a time. So while it took less than an hour to deploy 20,000 machines, it took 7 hours to delete all 20,000. So we had to patch Rally to be able to configure to delete more than 20 machines at a time. So a lot of the work that we're doing is driven upstream.
Okay. And Stig, I know you haven't begun yet, but what are your plans in terms of upstreaming? I know you have a kind of specialized use case. What are your plans for introducing this into the community?
Oh, as much as possible. So, it's interesting what you're saying about OSA, because one of the things that I'm definitely interested in evaluating is using OSA with Ironic, and there's a new playbook just in the final stages of formulation. Very interested in using that at scale and trying it out and working through that as a byproduct of what we're really interested in doing is like the end goal. I really want to try out all of these other new technologies that we just can't do on our test environment because it's just a little bit too small.
Okay. Yep. And what about community sharing? I believe when we spoke last week, you mentioned a working group for HPC. What are your plans there in terms of sharing and publicizing these things?
We had a meeting today, and there's huge enthusiasm for how the different scientific researchers from across the world can gather together and really kind of share their experiences, what's gone well, what's gone badly, how to do it right, that kind of thing. Everyone is really, really enthusiastic on how we do that. So the working group itself is going to be creating a lot of product in terms of just in terms of knowledge rather than in terms of software or capability. And I'm really excited about that. So I'm really pleased that we can actually bring together people and share this information. Of course, there's going to be a lot of stuff going upstream as well as we find it. I mean, coming from Cambridge University, we publish everything that we can that's relevant. So very excited to be contributing.
Great. And so for folks who might be interested in participating in OSIC, can you talk a little bit about the application process and any tips you might have for getting something accepted to letting people get access to the cluster, to the capacity?
Yeah, so when I signed up on, I think it was a Google Doc when I first signed up, I think that's a more formal process now, but I just put in there the tools that I was using and what I intended to use OSIC for, and then I think Andrew or somebody from Rackspace reached out to me and started the conversation, so.
Great.
Yeah, Emily? Very simple, fill in a form, and about within a month I had the had the allocation, so it worked very smoothly.
Yeah,
very easy to do.
Great. Any other thoughts from what you've seen on the Rackspace side?
Yeah, I mean, if you're looking to get accepted, definitely have very clear and concise descriptions of what you're trying to do, what you want to accomplish, and how you're going to publish that. And any way you can make that easier and more clear will help the approval process on your end. And if for some reason you get denied, it's no big deal, just apply again, and it'll go through the process. Next time around, have more detailed descriptions of what you're trying to do, maybe examples of something you've done in the past, and that helps the voting process that happens every 2 weeks. So.
Great. Well, I think we're going to throw it over to questions in a minute here. Do you guys have any final thoughts on your experience thus far, or any plans, any future plans that you see that you might want to do as follow-up work?
Yeah, so at Red Hat and Rackspace, we do have intentions to try to do another large deployment with triple O and try to scale it out even further, probably in the Newton timeframe.
Right.
I think the experience so far has been so positive. It's gone so smoothly that I can't imagine us not having another go. I think that I can think of all kinds of projects where it could be a really useful resource to have, where we have this scale which is, you know, that many times bigger than what we can gather together in our test lab. So it's a really exciting thing to have about.
Sure, great.
Yep.
Any closing thoughts?
And Ironic is the biggest thing we're working on right now at Rackspace to get deployed into OSA, and we're, of course, leveraging the OSIC environment to do that, because we have had requests that come in that only want maybe 1 to 10 bare metal nodes, and right now, with the way we manage the clusters, it's not easy to just serve that up, because we have to reconfigure the networking to make sure things are isolated from all the other environments in the cluster. So once we can get Ironic into the environment, into what we call Cloud One, we'll be able to meet those requests and have more people using the environment. So,
okay. Thanks a lot, guys. Do you guys have any questions for the panel? Anyone?
Right there.
Training materials. So if you go to osic.org, there is some material there on what's available. I don't think we have any processes for do we have processes for deploying?
We do. Yes, that's something Rackspace will provide to you, ways you can more quickly get deployed. Some people already have provisioning processes and they don't need what we have. But for those that don't, I personally have provided support to various people to get their clusters up and running.
So you get a good detailed inventory of your nodes and a network diagram, and it's usually enough to get started. So.
Yep. But in terms of osic.org, we're in the process of building the site, so some of that will be appearing on there as well. Other questions? No? All right, thank you, everyone.
Cool, thanks everybody, appreciate it.
Appreciate it. Thank you.